Well, good morning and welcome to worship. On this, the fifth Sunday after the Pentecost, it is a good time and place for us to be the gathered people of God. A welcome to those joining online as well as those out in the parking lot. A few announcements as we begin. First, so Tuesday, God willing, we're going to go on vacation from the 29th through the 8th of July. So Pastor John Martinson will be on call for emergencies. And the folks have his number as well as Julie in the office. So all of our bases in that regard are covered. And next Sunday will be a service of, this is good for Lisa to know too. So it will come to you in early amount of time. But I found a liturgy a colleague put together called Stories of Faith and Freedom. And so it's effectively a Lessons and Carols for the 4th of July. And it will be really fun, and so that will be next weekend, and then we'll have to pull it out again sometime when I'm actually here, because it just does look like a lot of fun to do. So that will be next weekend, all right? And then while I'm gone, no service on Wednesday evening in our backyard, so the 30th and the 7th, there won't be church out in the backyard. Other than that, my only announcement for the remaining announcement is that this afternoon into the evening, here is the visitation for Harris Haugen. He died this last week, 4 to 7 p.m. here. And his funeral is tomorrow at 11 a.m. So as you are praying, please hold Harris's family in your prayers. And his funeral will be available, like Grace's, live streamed as well from our website for those that can't get here for it. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? If not, then I invite you to stand as you are able and let us continue with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now hear the good news. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We join together in singing our gathering song.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Together, let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, we implore you to hear the prayers of your people. Be our strong defense against all harm and danger, that we may live and grow in faith and hope. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading this morning is from the book of Lamentations, the third chapter. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul, therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust. There may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. The word of the Lord. Our psalm this morning is portions of Psalm 30. We'll hear the response. I'll sing it, then join me the third time. Second reading this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you, who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something, now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had a little did not have too little. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand as we greet the gospel. For this day, according to Mark, the 5th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to all of you on this day. From God the Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. In J.R.R. Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings trilogy, there is a character named King Théoden. He has a son, Théodred, whose mother, Théoden's wife, died in childbirth. Now, if you're thinking about the movies, Théoden was the king of in Rohan. The Rohirrims were the horse people. Okay. So Théodred was the heir to the throne, but he was killed. Following his death, Théoden gave a short speech where he offers the words that have been said many times and in a variety of ways. No parent should have to bury their child. I regularly sit and share space, each month in fact, with parents who have lost children. I have for several years now helped to facilitate a support group in Wadena. It's a club that no one wants to be a part of. But it is a group that exists nonetheless, because sometimes the grief becomes too much. The finality, the hopelessness, the pain, the unfulfilled expectations, all of it simply becomes too much. and you need a place to go. So, this space exists for those parents. In our reading from Mark's Gospel this morning, we meet a father facing the imminent death of his daughter. Jairus, one of the rulers of the synagogue, comes to Jesus, falling on his feet. Surely he has heard about Jesus. Perhaps he has even witnessed his power. He was a desperate father seeking whatever means possible to save his daughter. In his fear and pain, he comes to Jesus seeking a miracle. And Jesus, hearing the plea of this father and meeting him with compassion, goes with him to see the child. And as they walked through the crowd, something odd happened. Now, you and I have the advantage of perspective. But place yourself in this scene for a moment, would you? Imagine hearing the conversation between Jesus and Jairus. Imagine the excitement and the curiosity building in the crowd around you. So the gathered crowd forming around Jesus and Jairus begin following them as they move in the direction of Jairus' home. Can you see the commotion? Can you hear the buzz of conversation? While Jairus was full of fear and helplessness, the crowd was likely experiencing a sense of expectation and anticipation. People were bumping into one another as this mass of humanity was moving, wanting to get as close as humanly possible, hoping to bear witness to a miracle. And then it happened. Jesus stopped walking. He started looking around, searching the crowd. Who is he looking for? The crowd must have wondered. And then he asked a question, which seems odd, probably to the crowd, the disciples, and to you and I. Who touched my garments? What? Who touched my garments? What sort of question is that? I imagine the disciples looking at each other, shrugging their shoulders as they repeated Jesus' question back to him. Maybe there's a little bit of sarcasm in their voice. You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, "Who touched me?" Jesus didn't respond to their questions, but kept scanning the crowd. He knew something they didn't. Eventually, overcome by her fear, a woman came forward, falling at Jesus' feet. Suddenly, all eyes were fixed on this woman at the feet of Jesus. Now, in all the uproar, it's easy to forget Jairus. While everyone else was focused on the encounter between Jesus and this woman, I wonder what was going through Jairus' mind as he stood there. Now, there's no mention of him saying anything, but I can only imagine what he was thinking. Why are we stopping, Jesus? My daughter is dying. We need to get home now. But in that moment, Jesus has shifted his attention to this woman. The text says that she told Jesus the whole truth. The truth of 12 years of bleeding, the truth of 12 years of suffering under many physicians, the truth of 12 years of spending all she had seeking treatment, the truth of 12 years of only getting worse in spite of all her efforts to get better. I wonder if she also spoke to Jesus about the rejection and the discrimination. The cries of unclean as she walked around town. I wonder if she talked about feeling unwanted, the judgmental looks from others, the people who walked on the other side of the street when they saw her coming. There are so many layers to the words Jesus spoke to her. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Her healing, you see, was more than just the end of the bleeding. She would gain standing once again in the community. She would be able to hug and be hugged. She would be able to experience the physical contact and the attention that she must have craved for those last dozen years. Yes, she would no longer suffer for her physical ailment, but I imagine the peace she gained is so much more. In one encounter with Jesus, she was reinstated into the community. The eyes that looked at her with judgment and rejection for years finally softened. The crowd was likely amazed at what had just happened. Now, in the midst of all this excitement, someone begins working their way through the crowd. A look of sadness on their face. A contrast to the smiles and likely confusion about what had just happened. This someone finally works their way through the crowd to Jairus, delivering terrible news. Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any longer? And suddenly the mood begins to shift in the crowd. I mean, what a roller coaster of emotions, right? This gathering experience. Concern, anticipation, confusion, joy, and now intense sorrow. Jesus, surely seeing and sensing what Jairus is feeling in that moment, he looks at him and says, "Do not fear, only believe." And at this point, Jesus disperses the crowd. He sends them away. Only Peter, James, and John are allowed to join Jesus and Jairus as they continue their journey to Jairus' home. Maybe he didn't want Jairus to feel overwhelmed by the crowd. We don't really know the reason. But it's this small group that gets to continue on. When they get there, the grieving is in full swing. People are weeping and wailing. All eyes must have turned to Jairus as he walked in with Jesus. Maybe a hush came over the crowd as the father returned home to his now dead daughter. But Jesus, it seems, has other plans than grieving. "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." Laughter, probably a nervous laughter, swept across the room. Jesus sent everyone outside and walked into the space where Jairus' daughter's lifeless body lay. Only Jairus, his wife, the three disciples with him. And he takes her limp hand in his and says to her, "Little girl, get up." I wonder what that first gasp of air was like when she came. Her eyes opening and making contact with her father and then her mother, who were surely overcome with emotion. And her surprise of seeing this man, Jesus, who held her hand. She got up, Mark's gospel tells us, starts to walk around and is surely wrapped up in an embrace by her mom and dad. And Jesus tells them not to tell anyone and to feed her. Went away. Mark chapter 5 is my favorite chapter in all of Mark's gospel. I commend the whole chapter to your reading. What an amazing sequence of events. What a variety of emotions. But isn't that how life is? Life is filled with unexpected moments of joy and grief and celebration and mourning. Our psalm this morning, we hear, "Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning." The psalmist speaks boldly of healing and restoration, mourning turned into dancing. We've all been there. We've all faced moments of darkness and sorrow, grief and loss. It might be a death or divorce, job loss, or battle with addiction. Darkness can come from a variety of places and spaces, and so often it feels overwhelming. There is a quote in the movie The Best Exotic Marigold Hotel that has been attributed to several people over the years, but regardless of who said it first, it goes like this. "Everything will be all right in the end. If it's not all right, it's not the end." I imagine both Jairus and the woman in our gospel reading can relate. How long did things not feel all right? Jairus went from despair to sorrow to joy. The woman went from suffering to frustration to restoration. And I don't know about you, but I find myself particularly drawn to this woman. How many times over that 12-year period did she feel helpless and hopeless? Imagine 12 years of not being touched, of being rejected by society, of being called unclean over and over again. How often did she wonder when it would all end, if it would all end? Jesus reminds us that resurrection is not a one-time event, but an ongoing reality. The woman experienced resurrection in both a physical healing and in her restoration to the community. Jairus' daughter experienced resurrection. She was quite literally brought back from the dead. Neither healing happened in the time frame, though, desired by those who suffered. 12 years of bleeding. Maybe 12 years of illness for this little girl. Richard Rohr says that resurrection is another word for change, but particularly positive change, which we tend to see only in the long run. In the short run, it often just looks like death. Resurrection, though, is a journey, not an event, and it's often a communal exercise. Resurrection is neither something we can do alone or something that God does alone. In the case of both Jairus and the woman, they took action. They didn't expect it to do it without Jesus, but they also didn't simply wait for him to act. God desires to partner with us in this act of resurrection. As the body of Christ, you and I are ambassadors of resurrection. Yes, we are recipients of resurrection through grace and mercy, healing and love. But we are also called to be conduits of resurrection. Pardon me. Offering others that same grace, that same mercy, and that same healing and love. We don't have to have all the answers, and we really aren't meant to. But even in the darkest moments, we can seek opportunities to take action. Listen for that small, still voice. Watch for thin spaces to appear where we can work with God to bring light into the darkness. We are never alone in this, even when it feels like it. Like Jesus did with Jairus' family and the woman who bled for 12 years, God is at work even now in the world. And God, beloved, is inviting you and I to join in and be a part of that work of resurrection. You and I are called not only to notice and point out God at work in the world, but to join God in bringing forth new creation, one moment at a time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as you are able, and let us together confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us come before the triune God in prayer. God of hope, the ministry of your church extends across borders, from nearby neighbors to far and distant countries. Accompany all those who labor eagerly in service of the gospel, that through your good news all might experience transformation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the air we breathe, the water we drink, the land that provides our food. Guard all species of plants and animals from harsh changes in climate, and empower us to protect all you have made. Lord, in your mercy, righteous God, we pray for nations and their leaders. Give them a spirit of compassion and steer them towards a fair distribution of resources, that none among us would have too much or too little. Lord, in your mercy. God of healing, your touch has the power to make us whole. We pray for those suffering from physical or mental illness. Embrace those who are sick. We pray especially this day for Aaron and Garrett, Tim, Jennifer, Pam, Ruth, Carla, and Sophia. For those in extended care from this community, for Darlis, Luann, Donna, Clarice, Addie, and Marge. Guard both day and night, dear Lord, those who serve in our military, both at home and abroad, for Reed, Michael, Matthew, Jordan, Lucas, and Mitchell, and those we name before you now in the quiet of our hearts. Surround them with your unwavering presence. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this assembly and all those gathered together in worship. Revive our spirits, renew our relationships, and rekindle our faith, that we might experience resurrection in this community. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for the faithful ancestors in every age whose lives have pointed us towards you. Envelop them in your love, that we may be reunited with one another in the last days. Lord, in your mercy. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your ever-abiding grace. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share that peace in some way. That in full and take all sorts of time that we need to do that in the days. But let us continue praying. Praise and thanks to you, Holy Father, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness. You called forth beauty from chaos, and you brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts. Freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you, for your word of life, O God.
We give thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love, for your word of life, O God. Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith. Increase our hope. and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive now the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As we go on our way today, let us do so singing, "Morning Has Broken." Now, beloved, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.